Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome you to King's Church. Thank you for coming. And welcome all of those who are watching online, live and later on YouTube, Facebook. Really nice to see you. Jill, do you want to start with any announcements?
Just to say thank you for all those who came and helped with the cleaning and sorting this week. We have done quite a lot of work, but there's still a little bit more to do. So if anybody's got any free time this week, that would be good to come and clean toys and help generally sorting all our stuff out. Other announcements, if you would like to give, there's a donation box at the back. We know a lot of people give online, and thank you for that, but we can't pass a plate round at the moment, so there's a donation box at the back. And then if anybody's interested in being baptised, do see John or myself. We're going to have a baptism fairly soon.
Yeah. We're hoping to start this Zoom course this week on the Bible. And I know we've announced that once or twice, but if anyone's interested in doing that, I'll send out an email maybe later today about that. And so if you come and talk to me or Jill about that as well, that'd be great. I think it's an 8-part course, and there's a short video, 15-minute video, and then we discuss it together through Zoom. So that's an overview of the Bible. It's a really good course. So let's just take a moment to be quiet, shall we? Holy Spirit, we welcome you here. Holy Spirit, come and fill this place with your holy presence. We wait for you. We wait for you. We wait for you to walk into the room. We wait for you. We wait for you. We wait for you. We wait for you to walk into the room. Here we are standing in your presence. Here we are standing in your presence. Shekinah glory come down. Shekinah glory come down. Here we are standing in your presence. Here we are standing in your presence. Shekinah glory come down. Release the fullness of your spirit. Shekinah glory come. Shekinah glory come. Release your fullness of your spirit. Shekinah glory. Shekinah glory, we wait for you. We wait for you. We wait for you to walk into the room. Here we are standing in your presence. Shekinah glory come down. Shekinah glory come down. Here we are standing in your presence. Here we are standing in your presence. Shekinah glory come down. Release the fullness of your spirit. Shekinah glory. Shekinah glory come, release the fullness of your spirit. folks, we want more of you. Thank you that you're here in this place this morning. Would you come, Lord, with the rain of your spirit and water us like a dry desert lands. Lord, we're thirsty for you, we're hungry. We're reaching out to you. We open our hearts to you.
Jesus.
everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit there at your feet and worship you. When you walk into the room, everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning, and nothing matters more than just to sit there at your feet and worship you.
give you my heart, I give you my soul.
Your name is love. Break every strong.
shine through the shadows, burn like a fireman. Your name is healer, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
Amen. Good. Well, if the kids want to go out with Jill, I think some have probably asked already. Jennifer, did you want to say about your outreach on the Humber Bridge?
Oh, this is Kim, my friend from Manchester. She's come to see us all. God bless her. Right, so we're starting a Humber harvest. So it begins tomorrow, and we're starting on the Humber Bridge. Are you coming on the Humber Bridge, Kim?
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. So I made some notes about the Humber Bridge because in 1981 it was built. It is a Grade 1 listed building connecting Hessle and North Lincolnshire, and it was the longest in the world at one point. Now it's the 11th, I believe. So there is there's been 200 incidents of suicide since the bridge opened, and there was a suicide barrier request that has not happened. And certainly I've had a lot of dreams about the bridge, and so we're going to bless it if anyone wants to join us. And we're going to do a Luke 10:2. So there's three of us. There's Billy Bumfrey, he's 21 years of age, never without a King James in his hand. And there's Ron, who's 73, and he just wants to serve. And there's myself. So we'd like to just bless the bridge and break that spirit of suicide in Jesus' name. And we're going to try and write to the Humber, the people that run the bridge, and ask if we can put a plaque, something with a message saying, you know, God loves you. But if anybody, does anybody want to join us tomorrow at 10 o'clock on the bridge, please feel free, because we're just going to be so spirit-led. We're going to do 5 days a week, 10 till 2, and just be led by God where he wants us to be. Because we recognise there's a population of, I think, is it 600,000, John, in the Humber, somewhere around that, in the wider areas. And Hull is my adopted home. I originate from Cheshire. And when I got baptised in November, it was very strong in my heart to just go out and serve and pray and just build the Humber harvest up. So we would really welcome your support. And we've been sort of guided to like go to the hospitals and go in the smoking bays and just speak to people and pray. And we just want the Humber harvest to be so strong, to just build up. If anybody has got a guitar, come and join us. And we're really excited about it. We just really want to serve, you know, and just bless this area. So there is going to be a kickstart, and we're gonna house it. John has been very kind in saying that we can house this, use this venue, and bring people all over from all over the country. who can just come and we'll do an outreach. So we can do Beverly, we can go across to Hull, we can go to all the different areas and just bless this area in Jesus' name. So please join us, message me, we'd welcome you there, and let's just serve. Absolutely, amen.
Amen.
Okay,
thank you, Jennifer.
Okay.
Good. Well, thank you, Jennifer. It's great to be here in church, isn't it? If you're too cold with that door, if you, you feel free to shut it. I know we also should have fresh air. But there we are. Oh, my tablet is... It's going to be one of those mornings. I am starting a new series today. I like to do series because then I don't need to think about what I have to preach about Sunday by Sunday. And I'm actually going to speak for the next few times that I speak on something I've never spoken on, I've never done a series on it before, and that's Israel. And we'll start at the beginning and go through a whole range of different things about Israel. And a lot of believers ask, why is it important for Christians to know something about this little country in the Middle East? I mean, after all, you know, we're British and the gospel has gone out to all the world. So why is it so important for us today to learn about Israel? I'm just going to start by showing a 2-minute video and then I'll get on to some of the...
Why should you care about a tiny state in the Middle East? This state was the birthplace of our faith, the place where the Holy Scriptures were written, preserved, and from here, spread to the ends of the earth. Our faith today is tied with this people and this tiny nation. God's promises made throughout the generations and those yet to be fulfilled. Israel, the place where the nations rage, the focus of the ire of media reporting worldwide, while also being the center of amazing innovations outpacing every other nation in the world. This tiny nation is not like the rest, because God isn't finished yet. Madmen throughout the ages have tried to extinguish this light, but God made a way, and the fulfillment of ancient prophecy has come to pass in our days, before our very eyes. Israel, a sign of God's covenant promises, fueled by grace for the glory of His name. But beyond the wars and miraculous rebirth, the story isn't done yet. The heartache cry of Paul in his letter to the Romans is bursting forth for Israel's spiritual rebirth. We're seeing an awakening in Israel that hasn't been seen since the time of the apostles. Millions are hearing the gospel in Hebrew and Arabic, Jewish and Arab pastors working as one, and leaders being equipped and working together for our Messiah. God is making a way for His church to rise in Israel, and you have a part to play. So why care about this tiny nation? Because you could be a part in bringing the gospel back to the root from which it came. And this awakening won't stop here in Israel, but that resurrection life will bless the church around the globe. So take your stand, join us in this historic work, and become one for Israel.
We may show another video at the end. Each time I talk about Israel, I'll show perhaps a little testimony of something that God is doing in the land of Israel to help us start to catch something of God's heart and what He's doing. You know, in these days, things are happening that have never happened for 2,000 years. And in the last 20 years, first, we've seen an amazing move of God among the Muslims for almost, well, since the time of Muhammad until about 20 years ago, there were very, very few Muslims saved. And suddenly in the last 20 years, hundreds of thousands are becoming Christians. And it was like that as well with the Jews in the land of Israel. For almost 2,000 years, there were almost no Jews. Well, of course, they weren't in Israel until 1948, but around the world, they were so resistant to the gospel. But in the last 10 years, so many have started turning to Jesus. And a couple of years ago, I haven't had the more up-to-date estimate, but a couple of years ago, they said that there were over 30,000 in the land of Israel, born again messianic believers, and every day there are more turning to Jesus, baptisms, strong churches established, and it's something that is truly historic, and later on we'll be seeing what that means in terms of, you know, God's plans for the world and the end times and all of that. But today we're going to talk about the birth of a nation. How did Israel start, and what does it all mean? And, you know, from the beginning of time, God's plan has always been to have a close, loving family. That's why God created mankind, because he wanted children. He wanted those who he could love and those who would love him. And he created Adam and Eve originally in the Garden of Eden. He put them in this amazing environment. And we read in the Bible, they walked and they talked with God. They knew him intimately. That's always been God's plan for mankind. That's God's plan for you. God wants to know you. He wants to walk with you and talk with you. He wants to be your friend. He wants it that you know him personally. However, as we read in the book of Genesis, mankind turned away from God. And through sin, things started going wrong. Adam and Eve were thrown out of that beautiful environment and had to fend for themselves in the harsh desert on the outside. And the first 11 chapters of the book of Genesis show us the sort of outworkings of the fall of man. You know, sin starts small, but it has a habit of multiplying. You'll discover that in your own life. If you turn away from God, it doesn't seem too serious to begin with. But if you keep going in that direction, it gets bigger and bigger and it snowballs. Adam and Eve, first they just did one little thing. They ate a forbidden fruit. But then in the next generation, one of their sons murdered the other one. The generations became progressively worse until in the time of Noah, it says in the Bible that every thought of every heart was only evil all the time. Imagine that. Every thought of every heart was only evil all the time. They became so bad that God said that he was going to destroy the world and start again. Everyone apart from one righteous man, Noah, and his three children and their wives. And you know, everyone in the world today, we're descended from Adam, according to the Bible. We're also descended from Noah. Every person on the earth today are descended from both Adam and Noah. And we'll think more about that in a minute. But Noah had this fresh start. Everyone, all the evil people were wiped out. They were placed on this beautiful earth again. But do you know, within a couple of generations, things had got almost as bad again. Noah's sons, Noah's grandchildren, they all started doing wrong. And then in Genesis 11, we read the story of a man called Nimrod. Now, there's just a few verses in the Bible. You can read more about him in the Babylonian literature. He was the grandson of Ham, one of Noah's sons, Ham. And he became the first emperor in the world. The Bible tells you where the first centers of his kingdom were. What it doesn't tell you explicitly, but you can read about in other ancient history, was that Nimrod was the first man who started killing people, warfare. He started fighting other people and making them subjects to him. He founded a kingdom. He was the first one to do that. It says in the Bible, it's mistranslated, he was a mighty hunter. But if you look in the subscripts underneath, it actually says he was a great warrior. And it says he was a mighty hunter for the Lord. You read the notes underneath, it actually should be translated, he was a great warrior against the Lord. And everything he did in his life was fighting against God and his commands and his kingdom. And he was the one that established the kingdom of Babylon, which would grow throughout the Bible and became synonymous with the kingdom of the enemy or of God. And as part of that project, as we know, he built the Tower of Babel. Now, we don't have time to go into that anymore today. That was probably also the start of people worshipping false gods. I won't go more into that. But at that point in history, God said, that's it, no more. No more this one family speaking the same language where people can get together and fulfill their evil schemes. I'm going to separate them to limit evil. And he divided the languages. People could only understand members of their own family and not their cousins or their far removed relatives. And because of the violence that they see with Nimrod, they were no longer able to trust people when they couldn't hear them and know what they were thinking. So they started spreading out across the face of the earth. So in those 5 minutes that I've just given, a very brief history of the fall, the downward trajectory from Eden down to this place, Babel, the founding of the kingdom of Babylon. That was the downward. But at that lowest point, God stepped in. And that was basically the start of the nation of Israel. I forgot to just say this, that at the Tower of Babel, when God confused their languages, the people basically spread out in three different groups. You probably know Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Shem, that's the Semitic people, what we call today the Israelis, and the Arabic people. Ham, his name literally means burnt or black. And you can see there, if you've got good eyes, you know, from the Tower of Babel there, they spread out, the Semitic people in the Arabian Peninsula and around there. The Hamitic, those of Ham, they spread into Africa. And the Japhetic up here into India and Europe. And as they spread throughout the world, up until the 15th century, that's where the people were. That's the Hamitic, the darker skinned people, the original Aborigines of Australia, they're descended from Ham. The Red Indians of North America, the Aztecs and the Incas, the Eskimos. Shem just inhabited this little part here and then spread eventually over North Africa and then the Indo-European people like that. And then I won't talk more, there's a whole talk I can give on that. But we're interested particularly in the Shemitic people, because at that low point when the nations were spreading out, dividing from each other, and it looks like God would never be able to fulfill his dream of having one family, because now all the families were scattered. One family who loved him, who would know him as they got further from their roots, of course, they drifted away from the knowledge of God as well. So at that moment, God stepped in to history. And it all started with one man called Abraham. He was still living there quite near to the old Tower of Babel when God called him. And God said this to him. He said, leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. Whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on the face of the earth will be blessed through you. An unlikely start for the beginning of a nation. This one man, Abraham, we'll talk more about him next time I talk, the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, why it is that that is so important. He couldn't have any children, and yet God took him and he said, I'm going to make you into a great nation. I'm going to make your descendants more numerous than the stars in the sky. And he promised he'd give him a geographical land which would be his and his descendants forever. And then God also said this. He said, I will bless you. Now we hear that word bless quite a lot in church, don't we? It's one of those religious words. We say, God bless you. And it doesn't really mean anything because we use it so often. But do you know, I want to tell you that the blessing of God is more real than many other things. You know, someone says, I'll help you. That doesn't mean a lot. If God says he will help you, that really means something. If God says he will bless you, that's the difference between life and death. Now, I have some friends that go quite a lot to the land of Israel, and they've told me on a number of occasions the blessing that is literally there in the land of Israel. And they say you walk along the border between Israel and Palestine, and you can see, you know, trees planted, and there'll be the identical tree on one side of the border, on the Israeli side, and on the Palestinian side, and they'll just be maybe a few hundred meters apart. But the fruit on the land that God has blessed in his land is bigger than the identical tree on the other side of the border. Now, there's no human reason why that should be. Here's a picture of some amazing lemons. These weighed over 5 kilos each. But it's amazing that the blessing of God actually works itself out in the very produce that is grown in that land. And God said to Abraham, he said, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless your children. I'm going to bless the land. I'll bless your finances. You're going to become, your descendants will be very rich. We all know about the Jews, don't we? How rich they are. God has blessed them. Blessed with intelligence. Many of the most clever people in the history of the world, the greatest inventors, were Jewish people. You'll be blessed with your health. You'll be able to create. You'll invent more things. And I will bless you so much that people will look at you and say, how come you're like that when I'm like this? What is the difference? And they'll be able to talk about the God that is blessing them. And then it goes on to say, through you, through this one man, Abraham, all nations on the earth will be blessed. That's an amazing thing, isn't it? Through this one man living 1,800 years ago, actually more, 3,800 years, 1,800 years before Christ, all the people on the earth will be blessed. How could that possibly happen? Well, at that point in history, something very special happens. So before the time of Abraham, God was equally the God of every person alive. He was the God of Ham, he was the God of Shem, he was the God of Japheth, he was the God of everybody in an equal way. But from the time of Abraham, and we need to really understand this if we're going to understand the history of Israel, God chose to limit himself so that his destiny, God's destiny, would be tied up with the destiny of just one people group on the earth. The people of Israel, the children of Abraham. He said, Abraham, I'm with you in a way that I'm not with all these other people. Although I'm the God of the whole earth, I'm going to limit myself just to become the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob now. And at that point in history and onwards, God chose not to reveal himself to any of the other tribes. He wasn't working with any of the others, speaking to any of the others. The heaven was closed for them for almost 2,000 years. Before Abraham, everyone was equal. Everyone had equal access to God. But from the time of Abraham on, it was his descendants that were the chosen. God chose them. They were the special ones who God was going to work with in a special way. And it was only them that he chose to bless. It was only them that he chose to be with. It was only them that he chose to reveal himself to. And so this amazing thing happened at that point in history, that for anybody else in the world, if they wanted to get to know God, the only possible way for them to get to know God was to listen to what God said to Abraham and his descendants, or to meet Abraham or one of his descendants. And that's still true today. The only way that anyone in the whole world can get to know God is by listening to what God said to Abraham or his descendants, because God revealed himself to Abraham and his children. And it was written down in a book that we now call the Bible. Do you know, every book of the Bible was written by a descendant of Abraham, apart from one book, actually two, but they were both written by the same person. Who knows what that book is? The book of Luke. Every other book was written by a Jewish author, and the book of Luke, we won't get into why he wrote that book and why it was included in the Bible, but the only way you can know about God is by reading a book that was written by a child of Abraham, or by meeting one of Abraham's descendants. You can't know God unless you meet one of Abraham's descendants. And you know, a couple thousand years after Abraham, a man would be born who was a Jew, who was also the Son of God. He would be the promised Messiah of the Jewish people. Yeshua HaMashiach. He was called Jesus the Messiah in our language. And you can't get to know God unless you get to know Jesus, the Son of Abraham. Through you, all nations on earth will be blessed. There's another scripture that sums it up in a clear way. Actually, this is spoken to Moses a bit later, but it makes the point while God says to the people of Israel, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all the nations, you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you, the Jewish people, you will be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. I just want to finish by saying this. God is not what we call today a universalist. You know, universalists, they believe that God loves everybody, everyone will be saved, every way leads to God. It's a slightly strange thing to believe that every way leads to the same direction, isn't it? I don't know how people can believe that. You know, at the end of the road, you can turn left or right, and those roads don't lead to the same direction. One goes to Driffield and the other goes to Hull. And God loves everybody, but he doesn't accept everybody. And this is so much against what the thinking that is there in the world today. God loves everybody unconditionally. There's nothing you can do that will make you too bad for God. Actually, there's also nothing you can do that will cause you to earn more of God's love either, because he loves you completely and he loves you perfectly, but he doesn't accept everybody unconditionally. And it's really important to understand that. In fact, your eternal destiny depends on you understanding that. Jesus, who people say he was probably the most loving man that ever lived, he said this. He said, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. Many enter through it, but small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Jesus said that only a few actually make that connection in the end with God. He also said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now that's hard for our world to understand. And it was hard in the day of Abraham to understand that there was only one nation. Out of all these nations that spread out across the whole earth, God didn't choose any of them apart from one. People go, well, God isn't like that. Yes, he actually is. The Bible says that. Clearly in hundreds of places. And it's like that today as well. Yes, God is offering his love to you. He offered his love in the time of Abraham and the people on. If they wanted to get to know God, they had to meet one of Abraham's descendants. They had to listen to what they were saying. If we want to get to know God today, the only way is by getting to know one of Abraham's descendants. There is a heaven, but unfortunately not everybody goes to heaven. When you die, do you want to go to heaven? Because there is another place, and that place is the place where God isn't. It's a place of darkness. It's a terrible place, a place of horror and torture and evil. That's called hell in the Bible. And the Bible is very clear that all those who don't give their lives to Jesus, that is where they're going. Now that's not God's choice, that is your choice, because he's offering you a way out of that. There's a bus that goes to Hull, and if I want to go to Hull, I have to get on that bus. There's a way going to heaven, and if you want to get there, there's only one way. Jesus Christ said that himself. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except through me. Now I'm just going to finish this little session by putting on another video. It's just last 6 or 7 minutes. And this is the story of an Israeli lady who comes to know Jesus.
ברית החדשה, אז בטח ספר כל כך רדוד, עברית גרועה, שקרים היסטוריים, מלמדים טעם שלנו לפחד מהספר הזה. באמת שהייתי בשוק. 2,000 שנה משקרים לעם שלי. אני באה ממשפחה מרוקאית, ישראלית. הייתי צמה ביום כיפור, יודעת את התפילות של הבית כנסת המרוקאי, אהוב עליי בקריאת אונו. קראתי בכל לב, ענני אדוני, חוקך אין צהורה. מי שמרוקאי יודע, זה דברים ש... אין יום כיפור אם לא שרים את זה ככה. בגיל 15 גיליתי סוד, אחותי הבחורה נהייתה נוצריה או משהו כזה, מאמינה בישו. זו הייתה סיטואציה מאוד לא קלה במשפחה שלי. כעסתי על זה מאוד, היה חשוב לי יהדות, ציונות, אמרתי מה זה, את בוגדת, את נוצריה עכשיו, את לא מהעם שלנו יותר, שטפו לך את המוח, את באיזושהי קאט, לא ראינו אותה. ארוחות שישי הרבה זמן. הלכתי לתנועת נוער הרבה שנים, הייתי מאוד רצינית בזה. הלכתי לגרעין, לחוות הכשרה, קומונה, צבא, נחל. בסיום השירות הצבאי פנו אלינו ממשרד הביטחון והציעו לנו ליישב בסיס צבאי נטוש בגליל. והקמנו שם קיבוץ. הרצנו אנשים כמו קארל מרקס, למדנו הרבה פילוסופיה, פסיכולוגיה. אנחנו נעשה חברה יותר טובה, חברה אוטופית, סוציאליסטית, אידיאליסטית. לא היה אלוהים, זאת אומרת, אין אלוהים. זה היה דבר ברור מאליו. התחלתי להתעסק בדו-קיום של יהודים וערבים, לעזור לזולת, לעזור לחלשים. והייתי בטוחה שאני בדרך הנכונה, שמצאתי את האמת. באיזשהו שלב התפקחתי, הבנתי שעם כל האידיאליסטיות, עם כל היפות נפש שלנו והאידיאלים היפים, ביום יום אנחנו לא חיים בצורה אוהבת אחד לשני. הבנתי שהכל היה בשבילי שקר, זה לא החיים שרציתי לחיות. חיפשתי את עצמי, הייתי די בדיכאון, מה כל ישראלי עושה? עובד ונוסע לטייל, אמרתי אני אסע לדרום אמריקה. בסוף הבנתי שאין לי מספיק כסף לטיול ארוך בדרום אמריקה, אז נסעתי להודו. מה עושים בהודו? כולם יודעים. בסוף, גם אם אתה נגד או בעד סמים, אתה מוצא את עצמך באיזשהו מקום, מעשן משהו. אני זוכרת שהייתי בגואה, קיבלתי מייל מאחותי השנייה. גם היא עכשיו מאמינה בישוע. עכשיו, זאת אחות שהייתה בקבלה, מדיטציות, ספיריטואליות, הילינג. ואני אמרתי, רגע, 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 מה קורה פה? עוד אחות אחת השתגעה, שטפו לה את המוח, היא נסתרפה לקט הזאת, נהייתה נוצריה. מה קורה למשפחה שלי? אני אתחיל לקרוא, אני אתחיל לחקור את זה. אני אלך ואני אוכיח להם שהם טועות. עסקתי ברית חדשה. ניגשתי לספר הזה בחשש. מלמדים טעם שלנו לפחד מהספר הזה. בטוח ספר גרוע, רדוד, עברית גרועה, שקרים היסטוריים. גיליתי אומץ, התחלתי לקרוא בזה, ופשוט באמת שהייתי בשוק. אמרתי, וואו, מה זה? זה ספר של יהודים. זה הכל פה בארץ ישראל. וישוע, הוא משלנו. למה משקרים לנו כל כך הרבה? 2000 שנה משקרים לעם שלי. ואני זוכרת שפשוט כל כך אהבתי את ישוע. אני באתי מחיים של סוציאליסטים, שמנסים להיות אנשים מושלמים ונהדרים בכוח של עצמם. ופתאום יש מישהו כזה כמו ישוע, שהוא כל כך טוב. פשוט בגלל מישהו, הוא לא מנסה להוכיח את עצמו לאף אחד. והוא חי חיים שבאמת מקבלים את האחר ואוהבים את האחר. ובשיתוף עם התלמידים שלו. אמרתי, יש אלוהים, אני רוצה לדעת בעצמי. לא רוצה דעת, לא רוצה שיגידו לי, את חייבת לעשות ככה וככה 100 פעמים, להתפלל. יש לי אלרגיה ורגישות לדעת, זה לא מעניין אותי דעת. גרתי אז בתל אביב, עירה חטאים. אני זוכרת שטיילתי עם הכלב שלי ליד הים, אמרתי, אלוהים, אם אתה קיים, תראה לי באמת. אם ישוע זה באמת המשיח, והוא הבן שלך, אני רוצה לדעת. אני באמת רוצה לדעת. ואם אתה אמיתי, אני אתן לך את כל החיים שלי. יותר ממה שנתתי, שהייתי בקיבוץ, סוציאליסטית, בגרעין, והייתי אחת המנהיגות, אני אתן לך הכל. וממש הרגשתי את הנוכחות של אלוהים ואת הנוכחות של ישוע המשיח, ופשוט אף אחד לא היה צריך להסביר לי. פשוט ידעתי שישוע הוא חלק מאלוהים. נפלתי על הרצפה בחדר שלי, חזרתי בתשובה, אפילו לא ידעתי מה זה לחזור בתשובה, לא הייתי בכיוון של זה בכלל. לקחתי את הסמים שלי, זרקתי אותם לפח, עם הבנגים, עם אקססות, עם הכל. באיזשהו שלב ההורים שלי גילו שגם אני מאמינה בישוע. אני בטוחה שזה היה להם מאוד קשה, אבל הם באמת ראו את השינוי בחיים שלי. הם ראו שאני הפכתי מאדם דיכוני ומבולבל וחסר מטרה, לאדם יותר שמח, יותר שלב. פשוט הבנתי שזה המשמעות של החיים, להכיר אותו. להכיר את ישוע.